So, consciousness clarified. That clarified in the title of this video would imply some sort of offering today. An offering of an explanation. An explanation that just might actually capture the dignity of a term that has arguably become one of the most obfuscated and confused conceptions plaguing not only our zeitgeist today, but for eons. My hope today is to offer some direction towards that understanding, as I am in no way the author of these profound ideas, but simply a humble messenger. These ideas were collected over the course of 2 painstaking years of research and personal development, and serendipitously came just in time for this Pace 1 contest. However, in the process of working on this project and reviewing some of the earlier submissions, this quickly evolved into something else, something much more salient. What I'll be sharing today are, in fact, the ubiquitous mental blind spots that occur in every one of us when attempting to grasp these profound explanations or even simple descriptions of both our physical noumenal world and consciousness. But I'm getting a little ahead of myself. So before we dive any deeper, I would just like to say that I'm immensely grateful for your attention today, your patience, but most importantly of all, your open-mindedness for what has undoubtedly become revelatory for not only the loved ones in my life, but of course my hope today for you as well. So, what's been the problem? What's prevented society at large to grasp and understand these 2 fundamental concepts? I mean, as succinctly as I can put it, modern society's current disarray stems from our current technocratic dependency on what has become a broken tool. That tool has contaminated the lifeblood a technocracy needs to cultivate its regime, the scientific method, and the ontologies of those who practice it. I mean, I myself came from the same school, was enchanted by the same eloquent sophistry of its most influential. I mean, we're all familiar with the names. Dawkins, Dennett, Harris, Hitchens. Their rationalizations maintain my mental security.
I think the modern understanding of consciousness, a la people like Sam Harris or Daniel Dennett, is that your mind is just physics. It's atoms bouncing off of one another. Consciousness, as we experience it, is purely phenomenological and is just an emergent property of that physics.
I would proudly echo their platitudes. But at its most basic, scientists are no different than you or me. Scientists are people of the senses, not people of reason. However, these academicians will shamefully sit on that throne of rationalism while having robbed that infallible reputation of mathematics.
The problem is not them. The problem is us. Let's start with me. The problem is me. Mm-hmm. I have this show. I've got a giant audience. People say, well, where's the portal? Why aren't you doing any new shows? And I'm thinking, do you know how a nerd you are to everything? You've decided that Jordan Peterson, Brett Weinstein, Joe Rogan, maybe Brian Keating, everybody, Sam Harris. I can tell you the things that go around about every single person as to why we can't listen to anyone who's not on script. I have failed.
Strip our scientists of this tool we call mathematics, with its now, what, hundreds of academic disciplines, and they become no different than the fanatical fundamentalists these new atheists claim to save.
Within 10, 20 years, nearly every branch of science will be, for all intents and purposes, a branch of computer science. Computational physics, computational chemistry, computational biology, computational medicine, even computational archaeology, realistic simulations, big data analysis, and ML everywhere.
Where's the mathematical constituency in academia screaming, sacrificing tenure for a more fundamental mathematical ontology? A more fundamental noumenal reality that's amenable to this phenomenal science? Look, I think we all felt that we would one day finally map this moral landscape, map this territory of qualia once and for all by determining these human qualities from these hollow and stale quantities like Chalmers described. But as Ananda K. Kumaraswamy explains in his many, many of his profound writings, and this coming from his book on Hinduism and Buddhism, where he offers his critiques on modern science and says, quote, "We must not suppose that the traditional wisdom is opposed to the knowledge of useful facts. What it demands is that we should recognize, in what are called facts and laws of science, are not absolute truths, but statements of statistical probability. The pursuit of scientific knowledge does not necessarily imply an ignorance. It is only when the motive is a curiosity, only when we pursue knowledge for its own sake, or art for art's sake, that we are behaving ignorantly." So the de facto practice of modern science today, I mean, given this myopic philosophical lens, omitting any degree of consilience, has placed itself on multiple quests to solve a hard problem of consciousness that's so hard, it's in fact insoluble.
First observation is, we are seeing science being abused in the name of quote-unquote science, okay? Capital S science is Maxwell's equations. That's
a good one.
That's a good one, right? Quote-unquote science is a paper that came out last week. And the key thing is that capital S science, real science, is about independent replication, not prestigious citation. Mm-hmm. That's the definition. Like, all the journal stuff, the professors, all that stuff is just a superstructure that was set on top to make experiments more reproducible. And that superstructure is now like dominating the underlying thing because people are just fixating on the prestige and the citation and not the replication, right? So how does that apply here? Once you start thinking about how many replications does this thing have, Maxwell's equation, I mean, there's trillions of replications. Every time us speaking into this microphone right now, you know, we're testing, you know, our theory of the electromagnetic field, right? Or electrical and magnetic fields. Every single time you pick up a cell phone or use a computer, you're putting our knowledge to the test, right? Mm-hmm. Whereas some paper that came out last week in Science or Nature may have zero independent replications, yet it is being cited publicly as prestigious scientists from Stanford and, you know, Harvard and MIT all came up with X, right? Yeah. And so the prestige is a substitute for the actual replication. So there's a concept called Goodhart's Law, okay? I'm just going to quote it. When a measure becomes a target, it ceases to be a good measure.
Whatever ability our leadership of days past may have once had to accomplish any degree of qualitative analysis, that's been long gone now.
Key question would be, we've had the Pentagon release multiple videos of strange UFOs that undermined a lot of us. I just think it's also really fascinating to talk about the fact that those of us who were trained to call BS on all of this stuff just had the rug pulled out from under us by the Pentagon choosing to do this. And you know what the effect of that is? You've opened the door for every stupid theory known to man. My aunt saw a ghost. Okay, now we're gonna have to listen to, well, hey, the Pentagon used to deny it, then it turned out there were UFOs, dude. Whoever is in charge of lying to the public, they need a cost function that incorporates the damage and trust, because I held this line that this was all garbage and all BS. Now I don't know what to think.
Just looking at the growing lineage of countless anthropological accounts of Goodhart's Law, of roads to hell, paved with good intentions, or the actual technical phrase, crossing a Chesterton's fence. Brett Weinstein and Heather Heng have recently popularized this conception, if you're not familiar with it. They dive quite deeply into the subject in their recent book, Hunter-Gatherer's Guide to the 21st Century.
Well, the idea is, basically, Chesterton's example is that two individuals are walking down a road and they encounter a fence across the road that appears to be serving no purpose, and one of them says, let's remove it, and the other one says, you can't remove it until you've explained why it was put there. Yeah. Because, of course, until you've done that, you don't know whether it has outlived its purpose or you're just not seeing it. And so we encounter this now all the time, right? Because our way of existing on this planet is changing so rapidly, we are constantly faced with the question of, is this or that feature of our lives an anachronism to be eliminated, that we could be more efficient without? Or are we going to discover what role it's playing after we've gotten rid of it? I mean, to take an extreme example, this fervor about defunding the police, right? Well, you'll find out what the police are doing, what effect they're having at a net level when you've gotten rid of them. And it's not going to be positive. It's it's easy to imagine that it might be, because the level of crime in a world in which the police chase people who commit them, right, is comparatively low. Right. If you've traveled to some place where policing has failed, you know that that's that the mm-hmm. effect is big, but if you only live in an environment where the police are mostly doing their jobs, you have no idea. So we can do that at every level, from physiological to social, and it's a crucial, yeah. crucial point.
So we talk about, for instance, some of the hubris of medical science in the 20th mm-hmm. century, in which at the beginning of the 20th century, there were a lot of doctors who said, well, clearly the appendix is not worth keeping, mm-hmm. which we now know to be an error as well. But not only that, the entire colon, the entire large intestine is probably just taking up space we don't need. And so there's this spate of surgeries yeah. to get rid of people's colons yeah. because Chesterton's fence wasn't alive in people's minds, yeah, yeah. right? And similarly, we invoke, so Chesterton's organs, like the appendix and the large intestine, mm-hmm. Chesterton's breast milk, really, you're just going to replace that with formula because you think it's just food? Well, it turns out it's got immunological information. It's got communication. Mm-hmm. It's got yeah. the mother-child bond. You know, right, there's just a lot that is there. And just because you figured out one of the functions of the thing doesn't mean that you figured out all the functions of the thing. And, of course, Chesterton's religion, Chesterton's gods, we invoke as well. You know, yeah. Too many moderns overthrow all that has worked in the past in favor of the new.
Yeah.
And often there is no new worth standing in for.
Dovetailing further from there, the prolific French philosopher René Junon, who has written expositions on nominalism, rationalism, traditionalism, endorsing such a concept, and published it 2 years, in fact, before Chesterton. As Junon writes in The Crisis of the Modern World, which is a quick aside, please pause this video. Go read Junon, Kumaraswamy. The links to their content are down below. As they've diagnosed and can prognosticate modern civilization today, to a staggeringly more sophisticated degree than I ever could. So don't just take my word for it.
Okay, so I think what's good about the perennialist, especially in my opinion, Guinot, is that Guinot is a great tool against the modern illusion. I mean, he's the best tool. If you read A Crisis of the Modern World, it smashes. You know, if you read that with an open mind, it will smash so many of your presuppositions about modern reality. And its accomplishments, let's say. So I think that I don't know if there's anybody better at doing that than he did. You know, The Reign of the Quantity is just a ruthless book. I even warn people, I say, don't be careful. Like, you read that, it can drive you crazy because it's like, if I smash your worldview, I can leave you teetering. I've seen people reading those. I've seen people reading, you know, become insane, like become paranoid and become like just weirdly paranoid because it really does smash something which is holding your world together.
Anywho, Junon writes, quote, "The same trend is noticeable in the scientific realm. Research here is for its own sake, far more than for the partial and fragmentary results it achieves. Here we see an ever more rapid succession of unfounded theories and hypotheses, no sooner set up than crumbling to give way to others that will have an even shorter life. A veritable chaos amid which one would search in vain for anything definitive. Unless it be a monstrous accumulation of facts and details incapable of proving or signifying anything. We refer here, of course, to speculative science, insofar as this still exists. In applied science, there are, on the contrary, undeniable results, as this is easily understandable since these results bear directly on the domain of matter, the only domain in which modern man can boast any real superiority. It is therefore to be expected that discoveries, or rather mechanical and industrial inventions, will go on developing and multiplying more and more rapidly until the end of the present age, and who knows if, given the dangers of destruction they bear in themselves, they will not be one of the chief agents in the ultimate catastrophe, if things reach a point at which this cannot be averted." Junon published that overwhelmingly concerning diagnosis nearly 100 years ago in 1927. Kumaraswamy's earlier quote was 20 years later. Now, there should be no surprise as to Junon and Kumaraswamy's perceptions were quite aligned as well. They were close friends. What should be surprising, in fact, incredibly problematic, is why haven't you heard of these academic juggernauts before? Well, as I was sort of alluding to earlier, in a globalized world of complexity mixed with a silent pandemic of stigmergic trauma, you'll engender a global technocratic monoculture. Simple. But being mindful of the unwitting suppression of thought given all this captured, exoteric speech from our sorry excuse of an education system, unfortunately, that answer I just gave should have gone over your head So before I continue on making what could only be described as unbelievable claims, extraordinary claims, I need to satiate Sagan's razor, of course, break down this claim and provide you all this extraordinary evidence, which, as a start, I think we can all agree, is a heck of a different pace from all the proclamations you're so used to today on the internet. You know, when one raises a grievance, one should be able to provide a clear and coherent solution. Today, you'll be receiving that Philosopher's Stone in the form of a Google Doc I categorize and even color-coordinated in order of importance to help anyone cohere their suffering. It's a compendium of primers in the form of lectures, discourses, books, and articles from the wisest who have ever lived and currently living. No differently, when anyone watches a tutorial on how a magic trick done, you know, in this case, the enchanting magic of ego, it simply loses its magic over you now, doesn't it?
Observe. A perfectly shaped square. We set it spinning, and now it's a perfectly shaped spinning square. But let's change our perspective, see what happens. By carefully blocking out certain parts of the spinning square, it now appears to have a pulsating effect, almost breathing in and out. Of course, it's only an illusion.
It's a disillusionary membrane that will actually grant you an ability to recognize the cause of all your distortive perceptual abstractions, so that you can finally name and therefore tame what ails you. You know, all the heuristics anyone would ever need, and best of all, it's mostly free. Worst of all, as is with most hard truths, it's incredibly painful. You know, think of it as a curriculum that the masses for generations have simply been deprived of, and led down this current myopic Cartesian paradigm of empiricism, reductionism, you know, hypernormalizing that an absence of evidence is in fact evidence of absence, that there is no implicit order to be found in all this apparent chaos. Okay. Well, I've done my job. I've publicly announced this salient course load, so I guess go forth, click the link below, and tremble at the world you all helped create. But not forget, you now have a map to understand the territory you face. As for the rest of you who'd like to stick around, I'm going to continue sharing my insights, more from the wisest amongst us, and hopefully make a shift in that perspective of yours from possible to probable, correlative to sine qua non. One of the leading Jewish philosophers and theologians of the 20th century, Abraham K. Heschel, raised some crucial questions when he asked, quote, "Is it not conceivable that our entire civilization is built upon a misinterpretation of man? Or that the tragedy of man is due to the fact that he is a being who's forgotten the question, who is man? The failure to identify himself, to know what is authentic human existence, leads him to assume a false identity. To pretend to be what he is unable to be or not, or to not accept what is at the root of his being. Ignorance about a man isn't lack of knowledge, but false knowledge. False knowledge breeds a false understanding. Garbage in, garbage out."
Academia is institutional and it's not innovative. For example, NIH has this graph, which is like, I think it's age of recipients of R01 grants, okay? And what it shows is basically it's like a hump that moves over time, roughly plus 1 year forward for the average age as the year moves on, okay? And I'll see if I can find the GIF. Why is this? Let me see if I can find it, actually. Look at this movie, just for a second. It's a ridiculously powerful movie, and it's 30 seconds. I just sent it in WhatsApp.
The name of the video is Age Distribution of NIH Principal Investigators and Medical School Faculty. And it starts out on the X-axis age with the distribution and percent of PIs. And from early 1980s, moving 1 year at a time. And the mean of the distribution is moving slowly, approximately, as Bellagio said, about 1 year.
Per year. Now, this is 10 years ago.
1 year in age per year of time.
And notice how, first of all, the average age is moving way upward before you become an NIH PI. Second is, it's a cohort of guys, people, who are just awarding grants to each other.
Yeah.
That's clearly what's happening. You know, that's the underlying dynamic. They're not awarding grants to folks who are much younger, okay? Because those folks haven't proven themselves yet, right? Mm-hmm. So it is this is what happens when you get prestigious citation rather than independent replication. The age just keeps creeping up. And this was 10 years ago, and it's gotten even worse. It's become even more gerontocratic, even more hidebound.
So civilization has continued to grow in complexity. Our scientific tools in which we use to understand that complexity need to proportionally align. So not just de jure, but also de facto, and therefore a more appropriate lens of consilience as opposed to this siloed scientific one never made its way onto the mainstream. Therefore, this false knowledge began compounding a complicitness towards tradition, towards these fallacious heuristics, and eventually a toxic, ubiquitous hubris. I mean, revered anthropologist Margaret Mead's famous quote that the problem with education is children are taught what to think and not how to think, of course, led to a scarcity in leadership. An overabundance of workers, therefore a plethora of demagoguery, so that our venerated age of information can hide in plain sight as an age of indoctrination. A petulant classist pedagogy that led to an environment of categorizations determining what we should compartmentalize. And we wonder why philosophy's reputation of perpetual agnosis? Listen, human beings can't really have free will unless they have been a serious truth seeker. But how many of us honestly take our lives that seriously? I mean, of course we all think we do. But serious means not only when your life is in crisis, of course, but also when all is going apparently well. How often do we really question all of these day-to-day assumptions when you utter them?
Truth is almost never a concern for people when it comes to making general decisions, especially about who they are, their identity, their mission, what they're going to support and not. Number three, freedom is a meaningless abstraction. The term freedom abstractly is something that people love, but the minute you say that you are then responsible for what you do with that freedom, they hate it. They want to be empowered, but they forget that power is in fact an awful burden. Number four, humans are not rational, and therefore they're not free. Rationality is hard. Rationality is difficult. Freedom is almost impossible for most people, because that means you have to use critical reason all the time. Number five is that to be human, you have to be both rational and free. That's the nature of humanity. Otherwise, you're just this hunk of flesh on two legs. So number six, free will is a result of ascetic struggle and study. No one's born this way. Free will, if it's really free and it's really willful, is usually nothing but pain.
Austrian philosopher Ivan Illich shares this perspective, where he wrote a book on deschooling society, creatively titled Deschooling Society, published back in 1971, his commentary on academia, where you'll quickly recognize is as relevant then as it is now. Ivan says, quote, "Many students, especially those who are poor, intuitively know what schools do for them. They school them to confuse process and substance. Once these become blurred, a new logic is assumed. The more treatment there is, the better the results, or escalation leads to success. The pupil is thereby schooled to confuse teaching with learning, grade advancement with education, a diploma with competence, and fluency with the ability to say something new. His imagination is thereby schooled to accept service in place of value. So medical treatment is now mistaken for healthcare, social work for the improvement of community life, police protection for safety, military poise for national security, the rat race for productive work. Health, learning, dignity, independence, and creative endeavor are defined as little more than the performance of the institutions which claim to serve these ends. And their improvement is made to depend on allocating more resources to the management of hospitals, schools, and other agencies in question. Mass secularization will then morally, which means good or bad, which means attach or ignore, will morally compartmentalize thought, will therefore rigidly and criminally compartmentalize these simple yet obfuscated conceptions of nature and nurture, consciousness and culture, matriarchy and patriarchy, mythos and logos, body and mind, chaos and order, sending our intellectual leadership down an endless path of question begging, when we've known, you've known, deep, deep down, all along, that both have always been related. That the only metaphysical reality out there can be the monistic one. That everything affects or is related to everything else to either a subtle or severe degree. You, my friend, just had no idea what to measure, what should be perceived, ideally perceived in this given moment in time, and therefore delineate that hierarchical chain of cause.
Religion is inevitable. This is one of the things I try to help people understand, is that you need hierarchies of attention. You need to organize the world in hierarchies of goods, of values, of virtues. This is something which you cannot avoid. And if we try to avoid it, it's going to come back to us in very strange and disturbing ways. And that's what we're seeing now. We're seeing the religious flood back in, but in a very dark and strange manner. Mm. And so the question is, what is it that we worship is what we have to start asking ourselves.
Okay. Today, you can finally begin that coherent journey of discovery. It's always just been a matter of trying to understand, but again, to what extent do humans really attempt to understand the assumptions in their relationships? So intellect has now replaced wisdom.
I think that under some conditions, people can... vision can expand to the point where they can see down into the micro level. They can apprehend the micro level consciously.
You think that our consciousness can extend down to the micro level, yeah. To the level of...
I do.
The micro level of, yeah. of DNA. Okay.
Well, since we're on this topic, I have taken extremely high doses of psilocybin. Like 4 doses is enough basically to knock you out of your body. I wouldn't recommend it casually. I took 7 grams 3 times. And I had this shamanic experience. It was unbelievable. And I don't even know how, I have no idea how to make sense out of it.
Well, I believe that. I can quite understand you have a most extraordinary experience. I've never taken such a drug, but I could imagine you had the most remarkable experience. But you've just said that you think that your consciousness can see into your cells and see the structure of DNA. That has got to be utter nonsense. I'm sorry.
Well, like I said, I'm perfectly reasonable, willing to admit forthrightly that that is a highly speculative idea.
Well, it is speculative, but it's also got to be false.
Why?
Opinions are now to be respected as informed opinion and are captured. Scientific empirical descriptions now become accurate explanations. Now, I don't claim to have all the answers, just all the right principles. Let me try to explain that. You have a lot of doors you want to walk through in this life, a lot, but can't quite figure out that lock, its obstacles, so that you can one day walk through this door, this challenge, and meet your newfound wiser self. With these conversations, these lectures, workshops, profound books that will shatter your being, are an apprenticeship, so that you can become that key maker, so that you can finally unplug yourself from Maya. I tell people every day they got indoctrinated chronologically, so naturally one would need to unindoctrinate themselves chronologically. Got a chicken and egg situation on our hands here, so please, if you can resist that succulent pull of instant gratification that is oh so familiar to the modern ego, please complete what I labeled as essential first before you begin that second page. I mean, it is the prerequisite knowledge necessary to not only understand the true meaning, the true depth of the syntactical usage of my utterances today, but to get at the heart of our current meaning crisis. As for the initiated who are familiar with those essential intellectuals mentioned, please begin with that wisdom section. And as you'd probably guess, start with the work of Jnana and Kumaraswamy. I mean, their critiques and expositions on the metaphysical doctrines of the Upanishads and Gita, Plato and Meister Eckhart alone, and how they complement one another, marrying East and West, should stir an urgency in anyone. But, you know, if their raw works are too hard to resonate and penetrate, you know, not to worry. I got you. Brilliant. And the most comprehensible explanations of Janon's works are available by Dr. Matthew Raphael Johnson. Dr. Johnson is a scholar of the Russian Orthodoxy's history and philosophy, and here he is wrapping up an explanation of Janon's perceptions on nominalism in the modern era. And let's remind ourselves that modern was nearly 100 years ago, a lot of proclamations on truth ago.
If there are no intrinsic relations among natural objects, what that means is then the scientific establishment can create those meanings and those relationships and those ends. And of course they're going to do so from their own point of view and in their own interest. Unity in the rationalist and nominalist mind is impossible because the unity is part of the sort of supersensible relation among objects. But the superindividual is something that objectively exists. The unity of human traditions, the Jungian archetypes, for example, symbols which are in common civilizations that probably had no contact with one another. It's one of Junon's major arguments is that natural law functions the same in all human societies. They have the same needs, the same desires. They're almost all based on the family and virtues that come with the family. In other words, the proof of natural law and the proof of realism against nominalism is that societies around the globe, not only in space but also in time, going back to the earliest records of mankind, have the family as the basic unit, usually the extended family. From that, there is deduced a whole bunch of virtues, you know, loyalty and solidarity and the headship of the man as the main protector of the family, etc. These exist in every society that has ever existed. There is no society that ever rewarded cowardice as somehow a virtue, or ignorance or stupidity as somehow a virtue. These are things that are built into the very nature of the cosmos and of human relations, and we partake of that cosmos within logos, within the idea of the unity of created things as an immaterial formal quality, one that exists inherently, not one that is placed there by the scientific establishment. Nominalism is false because it can't make any sense out of the commonalities of universal metaphysical systems, of universal virtues which are protected in every society on the globe. Adultery is punished on every society that has ever existed. Adultery is considered a bad thing. Family is considered a good thing. Only in late modernity, and the absolute domination of the scientific establishment and technical control, only then do you see these natural institutions begin to fall apart. And in fact, the very denial that they're natural institutions in the first place. Nominalism hides behind the scientific bureaucracy, but it cannot make sense out of all of the formal connections amongst different peoples throughout the world, thousands of cultures that never had any contact one with another, and yet they all have a concept of God, they all have a concept of family, and hence things like adultery and faithfulness. They all have some kind of a military force, and they reward valor and bravery. They're all the same in that particular regard. Now, how these things are manifest day-to-day, that, of course, is going to change, and that's the basis of a nation, ethnic group. It's the same formal qualities, just they're organized a bit different language and different set of stresses and different sets of emphasis. But that's the proof that nominalism is false. The fact that the family, the tribe, the ethnic group, these are usually with a religious grounding, a cultic grounding, are the ultimate foundations of societies around the globe until the modern era, proves that these things are super sensible and super individual. The fact is, and this is Junon's brilliance, is the concept that truth does not exist in the nominal and positivistic world. Truth is truth because the scientific establishment or the state says it's true. And it's true because it's useful, and it's useful for one group of people over another. If you want to reduce truth to the ability to use something, utility, you've now destroyed the concept of truth and substituted in its place the fact that something may work for a certain end. Those ends usually are not yours. Those ends usually are in corporate America or the state or the military apparatus or whatever.
Powerful. I know. There's a lot more where that came from. Matter of fact, actually just published an incredibly timely book on nominalism titled The Ontology of Death, the Patristic Philosophy Against Nominalism. As for Kumaraswamy, his son, Rama P. Kumaraswamy, entrusted all his works to the enigmatic Ken Wheeler. Ken is an ancient Pali translator and all-around straight uber genius polymath who has thousands of videos on metaphysics. And as you can see from Ken's Aurea Sapientia, I think I'm pronouncing that right, which translates to Wisdom of Gold or Golden Wisdom, as well as his book on magnetism, Ken can not only explain our physical noumenal world, but in fact, the metaphysical and consciousness itself.
I like to go over this to a certain depth without getting super deep and possibly boring you to death and differentiating out mind and consciousness and a lot of the confusion that's even existed for thousands of years amongst the Sarvastivadins and the Mahayanists. They would actually debate about the nature of mind. In the case of the Pali, the term is chitta. By the way, that term is also, too, the exact same term in ancient Egyptian. Fascinatingly enough, and this video is not about this, the most important terms in ancient Pali are also the exact same words in ancient Egyptian. The ancient Egyptian term for the soul, the Aten, is the exact same term in ancient Pali, Aten. Let's see how different these sound, Aten and Aten. And the Sanskrit word is Atman. We actually have the same word in English, atmosphere, atmospheric, talking about winds, that which bloweth and listeth. However, we're not talking about literal winds, we're actually talking about the pneumatic principle, i.e. the animus, or the Latin spiritus sanctum. Yes? Talking about the animating breath of life. I'm sure you've heard words breath of life before. But the distinction is one is consubstantial and the other one is transcendent. Interestingly enough, the Greeks and the Indians on many different levels actually were extremely acute in having their language definitions. Like in Greek, zero is not a number, and one is also, too, not a number. It's actually the principle, so one is not a number. Also, too, the ancient Pali word for consciousness, yes, also means ignorance. The word for consciousness, or empirical consciousness, which is the consubstantiality of the signal and the radio, which in manifestation is a near-perfect analogy in the radio analogy that I'm making. The broadcast, of course, would be the life, you know, the individual life, which is Cartesian, you know, Bob, Sue, Larry, so on and so forth. But the word for consciousness literally means ignorance. When you read the word vijnana, it's prefixual vi in Romanized Pali, which means opposite to, inverse, or in the opposite direction of, and after that the word is jnana. Jnana is just the Pali word for gnosis. So the ancient Pali word for consciousness, empirical consciousness, yes, is also the word for ignorance. And metaphysically, that is perfection, because empirical consciousness, which cannot be purified, it goes no further than the psychophysical or the corporeal entity, just as the broadcast does. People think superficially, because you were never taught to think like this, and neither was I, that if I were to turn on this radio, which I don't need to do, that, you know, the broadcast is also to the signal. I'm tuned in to 154 megahertz. I'm listening to the broadcast of 154 megahertz. Well, you are, but the broadcast is tuned by the radio. It's interpolated, and then it's sent to a speaker, and the speaker broadcasts it. So I see how someone would be confused in that the broadcast, and the broadcast is a perfect analogy for consciousness with the signal, but that's not the case. Now, if I were to shine a white light through, I don't have a filter in front of me here, if I were to shine white light through a red filter, one would say, well, there's the light. It's like, yeah, but that red light is consubstantial with the filter. In other words, the signal would be the light, the white light, and then, of course, the consubstantial red light is the combination of the two. It goes no further than the filter. That red light is the consubstantiality of the filter and the light. But that red light is not the signal. It is completely dependent upon something else. The ancients accurately and with pure perfection, specifically the Greeks and Indians, Advaita Vedanta, original Buddhism, the Upanishads, specifically the Udana, Iributaka, and Suranapada, on describing and defining empirical consciousness accurately, and of course the word literally means agnosis, as the consubstantiality of spirit and matter, of which that would be the Cartesian or corporeal broadcast, if you will. In other words, the cogitation, in this case we're talking about a living an animus broadcast. Kind of a near-perfect analogy that would be like a sentient signal, which goes no further than trying to think of like the Terminator analogy where the signal itself is sentient. That's kind of an obtuse analogy, but it's kind of perfect that we all grew up with this Terminator nonsense, watching these movies about a sentient signal and these sentient robots, you know, these cybernetic organisms, where the signal itself is self-aware, self-conscious. But it goes no further than the consubstantial or corporeal entity that it is. The same in the near-perfect, not perfect, but near-perfect analogy of the radio and the broadcast. The broadcast, of course, is consubstantial, meaning it's completely dependent upon the radio. It goes no further than that. And all of us don't think like that. We think the broadcast is the signal. It's like, no, that's not the case. The signal is one thing, and it has a modulation, and that modulation is interpolated and processed and then broadcast through the speaker of a radio. But the broadcast is not the signal, because the signal is ever-present. Whether I smash this radio, or the radio breaks, or the batteries die, the signal itself is ever-present, and it is non-Cartesian. When it is tuned, then it becomes Cartesian, because now it is being broadcast through the radio.
Isn't Ken incredible? I imagine much of the TOE audience are going to be huge fans of Ken and Matt in no time. However, if neither Ken or Matt haven't sent reverberations of resonance through your bones yet, this is where I come in. And I would implore you to take my recommended of importance of order seriously. Begin with that body section and Dr. Mate's work on how modern environmentally induced trauma has shaped nearly all our reflexive perceptions in real time.
I had kind of a falling out with my husband's family, my in-laws.
You had a falling out. Tell us what happened. You had a falling out with your husband's family.
You know what? I just I never felt that they accepted me. Like they never, I was never good enough.
Okay, I'm going to interrupt right away, okay? Lisa says, I never felt like they accepted me. That's not a feeling. There's no such feeling like they don't accept me. Feelings are, I'm tired, I'm hungry, I'm sad, I'm angry. Those are feelings. That they didn't accept, that they don't accept me is not a feeling. It's a perception. It's a point of view. Understand that? No, I'm not saying it's wrong. I'm just saying it's not a feeling. What do you feel when you perceive that they don't accept you?
Rejected.
Okay, rejected is not a feeling. Okay, feelings are, I'm tired, I'm angry, I'm sad, I'm hungry. Okay, those are feelings. Rejected is a perception that they're rejecting me. What do you feel when you perceive that you're being rejected?
Unloved.
Unloved? Unloved is not a feeling. Okay. No coaching, okay? Unloved, feelings are, I'm tired, I'm hungry, I'm sad, I'm angry. Unloved is a perception that somebody doesn't love me.
Make me angry.
So there's anger there.
Oh,
that's a feeling, thank you. And even before you feel angry, what else is there? How does it feel when you think somebody rejects you, doesn't love you, doesn't accept you? Is there not hurt there? Hurt, there's pain. There's pain and anger, right? Okay. Now, did something specifically happen? Remember I said something happened? So what happened?
It was just a series of multiple
things
that built up.
Just give me one.
My father-in-law came over.
Yeah.
And I said, you know, we have a new house. We've been in it 2 years. And the one side has landscaping in the backyard and the other side doesn't. And I'm like, yeah, you know, we were thinking about just putting a tree or a shrub over there or something, you know. And he's like, yeah, just go and buy a $500 tree. That'll look great.
Buy a $500
tree. That'll look great.
Okay.
Like, okay. I didn't say
and,
I was going to spend.
And for you, that was interpreted as rejection, not acceptance, being unloved, right?
I mean, he made it seem like I wanted to spend my husband's money on a $500 tree or a bunch of land.
Right. Okay.
You know, I should feel lucky that I lived in the house.
No, but you experienced that as a rejection, as not being accepted, not being seen, being misinterpreted as unloved, right?
Fair enough? Yes.
Okay. So, Lubet, tell us your story.
Yes, I think it happened earlier this week with my 5-year-old. So,
your 5-year-old, okay.
Yes. We had booked a vacation, and we were really excited to tell her about the vacation.
Yeah.
But when she heard about it, she not only was she not excited, but she
What did she say?
She said, "I don't want to go there. I want to go to Cabo."
I don't want to.
I don't want to go to Jamaica. I want to go to Cabo.
Oh, she wants to go to Mexico. Yeah. I don't want to go to Jamaica. I'm going to go to Mexico. That's what
I
she said.
I want to go to Cabo. We had just got back from Cabo last week.
I got it.
And so we were planning our vacation
and
for next year.
And so you felt what? What was the upset?
Well, one, kid, you've been to Cabo 3 times. And we don't want to have to go back there again. And also, like, you're 5 years old. You don't get to make those decisions.
Okay. So what did you feel?
Also felt, like, rejected that was sad that was her.
What upset you about what she said?
Maybe that I felt like she was being ungrateful.
She was being ungrateful.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, I got news for you.
Mm-hmm. She's 5, right?
No, hold
she's
on.
She's ungrateful. No, being ungrateful for a long time.
guess what the news is? The news is that there's no such thing as I felt she was being ungrateful. That's not a feeling.
Mm.
It's a perception.
Okay.
You perceive that she was being ungrateful. Maybe you were right.
Right.
But it's still only a perception. What did you feel when you perceived that your 5-year-old is ungrateful?
Probably a lot of it was also feeling that, like, at her age, I didn't have any of those opportunities, none of those chances.
That's not a feeling.
Right? A feeling of, like, I would have loved to be able to go to Jamaica or Cabo.
Not a feeling.
No.
Okay. I get that at age 5, you would have loved to have had that kind of privilege.
I was just feeling pissed at her. I mean, honestly, when she turned around, I flipped her off, but luckily she wasn't looking.
You felt what? Sorry?
Nothing.
But you felt angry?
I felt angry,
yeah. And you felt hurt too, probably.
Mm-hmm, yeah.
What were you hurt about?
Well, that I love her and I want her to be happy.
And yes, you do love her, and I get that 100%. You do want her to be happy. What did you feel hurt about? She doesn't appreciate you.
Right.
Okay?
Right.
She doesn't appreciate
you. Right.
Okay. That we all share this mass dogmatic hypnosis, truly, regardless of your status in society.
Of all the possibilities that you've just outlined, including that they don't care about you or respect you, which is the worst one?
The one I immediately defaulted to.
Right.
Well, so, I mean, the worst. If the guy's dead, then it's bad.
But internally.
Yeah, internally, the worst assumption is the one that I immediately made.
Exactly. So let's notice something.
A, you, I should say we, because we're all like this, we don't respond to what happens.
Mm-hmm.
We respond to our perception of what happens.
Right.
Okay? That's what the Buddha said. It's with our minds we create the world. So that if you'd found out he had ADHD or he was stressed, or you might have been sad for him, but you would not have been angry and you would not have been sad. Okay? You might have, So, first of all, we don't respond to what happens. We respond to our perception of what happens, to our interpretation of what happens. Number one. Number two, of all the possible interpretations, we choose the worst one.
Yeah.
Number two. Thirdly, what I just said isn't true. We didn't choose it. It's not like you went through all these possibilities and you right. said...
Was it multiple choice and I chose option D?
Oh, no, he doesn't care about me. He doesn't respect me. You didn't do that. Your brain jumped there automatically, right?
Mm-hmm.
The question is why?
Yeah.
Now, here's the learning. First time in your life that you felt hurt and angry, that you when you perceived somebody didn't care about you or didn't respect you, or has it happened before?
This is where the exercise might go sideways. I'm going to hit pause on that. I think that's probably for more of a conversation over wine.
But you'd probably agree it's not the first time.
It's not the first time.
Very good. And most people I talk to, it goes back way back.
Yeah, this goes way back.
Into childhood.
Mm-hmm.
Okay? And that's what trauma is. We don't respond to the present moment. We respond to the past. Now, but along the lines of our discussion, it's a beautiful learning opportunity. Now you get to know. Now, what if you assumed for a moment that you're the most lovable, most worthy of care, most worthy of respect person in the history of the universe? And this guy doesn't do your home. What's your response?
Any number of the other options, which does not trigger an intense negative emotional state.
Yeah.
None of those other options would trigger that.
So something in you, I would argue, still believes that you're not worthy of care and respect.
Mm-hmm.
And that's what gets triggered. So who's the one that doesn't care about you, and who's the one that doesn't think you're worthy of respect?
No, it'd be me.
It'd be you.
Yeah.
So that's a learning.
No, it is.
And this is exactly what you're talking about. You're saying how these difficult things, how these... problems are always teaching opportunities, and that's the beauty of healing, is that when you reframe things and you actually see the source within ourselves, all of a sudden that's liberating. Because guess what? If you're feeling that way because this guy did this or didn't do that, that makes you a victim.
Yep.
But if you see that you're the source, now you're powerful.
This is the core reason why adequate and productive communication is so rare. Peeling the onion a bit further, this being what biologists and anthropologists and some renegade psychologists and philosophers alike describe as stigmergy. You know, what is stigmergy? Taking from Marsh and Onoff's abstract on their paper titled Stigmergic Epistemology, Stigmergic Cognition, they explain, quote, "To know is to cognize. To cognize is to be a culturally bounded, rationality bounded, and environmentally located agent. Knowledge and cognition are thus dual aspects of human sociality. If social epistemology has the formation, acquisition, mediation, transmission, and dissemination of knowledge in complex communities of knowers as its subject matter, then its third-party character, which again, at its most basic, is every description of you you have ever heard in your life, is essentially stigmergic. In its most generic formulation, stigmergy is the phenomenon of indirect communication mediated by modifications of the environment, or what we might call context. Extending this notion, one might conceive of social stigmergy as the extracranial analog of an artificial neural network providing epistemic structure. So knowledge and cognition are therefore the two essential elements for communion to even occur. Just try and explain anything to anyone, but this time, explain it not in terms of something else. So something as basic as the syntactical arrangement of my utterances and its exoteric, its nominalistic interpretation, both in terms of what they commonly connote and denote, will unwittingly pull you down a stream of illusory rationalizations and projections based on a cascade of your stigmergic interdependencies. Let's take our stigmergic, our nominalistic understanding of this definition of addiction. Society has no relationship to Gabor's much more fundamentally qualitative definition of addiction, which is any behavior. And that's as vague as a category as it gets. Any behavior that can offer us respite, relief in the immediate short term, despite giving rise to long-term consequences. And you discontinue that behavior despite maintaining those long-term consequences. The revered individual leader seeking order in whatever social group, you know, their Dunbar, in the short term, despite the long-term consequential chaos, is but one end of this existential goalpost. Of course, the other can be seen again and again across various societies, crossing that Chesterton's fence, missing that forest for the trees, which of course runs in the face of this reputation of these apparent giants we stand on the shoulders of. They were submissions to this Pace One contest that offer accurate explanations of both physics and consciousness. And they will continue to fall on deaf ears because of the blinding, this deafening effect from our stigmergic trauma. Once you familiarize yourself with the content provided and how subtly, trauma shapes your perceptual lens in real time, you'll learn that bias is simply a stigmergic cascade of all your stigmergic interdependencies that form your identity, your ego. It becomes a true house of cards, well, for the uninitiated, which is where all your projections of absolutist rebuttals and debate actually come from, by the way. So no to all those who may have felt at any point of this video that I was may have proposing we throw our baby named science out with the bathwater. You know, we just got to clean that baby.
As critical as I am of FDA, or the Fed for that matter, I also actually recognize that like the Ron Paul type thing of end the Fed is actually not practical. End the Fed will just be laughed at. What Bitcoin did was a much, much, much more difficult task of building something better than the Fed. That's really difficult to do because the Fed and the FDA, they're like the hub of the current system. People rely on them for lots of different things, okay? And you're gonna need a better version of them, and how would you actually build something like that?
And this is why knowledge will always have power, when wisdom is strength and can withstand any intellectual, knowledgeable claim. Knowledge will always have an effect, sure. However, wisdom is always effective.
In all our efforts to heal our psyche and raise consciousness on the planet, we have all but overlooked the very instrument of conscious thought and communication. Yet our forked tongue English language, which is the leading software of the Western mind, is itself in great need of retuning and upgrading. Over the course of my life, I cultivated a heightened sensitivity to how the total normality of insanity in society is echoed, reflected, and reinforced by the English language, which inadvertently yet unavoidably propagates an antiquated and manipulated vision of reality promulgated by the ancient church as an instrument of mind control at a time when people had to surrender their mind if they wanted to keep their heads about them, quite literally. So if we elect collectively to upgrade the English language to a higher frequency through our linguistic creativity and naturally occurring verbal eccentricities, then ultimately, even clatter from our idle chatter, prattle patter, blabber blather and palaver as we jabber gab and babble on, will turn our glowing terms from verbal vapor, either hanging in the air or trapped on paper, into tiny bits of shiny matter as we gather, chat, and natter on, and with new skill at trilling, thrilling statements that instill fulfilling imagery of higher possibilities, will finally still the quiet riot of the wild child's manic panic through the mind, so we can flip the switch, enlightening every circuit of our consciousness with the electric surge of verbiage that encourages superb and selfless services to spread from soul to soul around the globe by what is said in all the light years up ahead. And then, from the islands of silence between all that's spoken, we will listen as doors to the heartland spring open.
Hopefully your immature relationship with language is really starting to show itself and how easily it can unwittingly steer perception. Recently, neuroscientist and psychologist Dr. Jordan Peterson and Dr. Andrew Huberman blessed us with an incredibly timely conversation on the latest in neurology, the way humans and animals react to specific stimuli and how this knowledge can be utilized for personal growth. There's been a huge acceleration in the recent years in our understanding of the brain and its functions.
Whoa, that's where the science has gotten us at this point. So you say, okay, don't tell me about there's no free will. We can't liked any of that stuff yet. But the point that I always wind up making is, yeah, that's true. But look at what we know about the biology of behavior at this point, and 99% of it we've learned in the last century. 50% of it we've learned in the last 10 years. 25% of it we've learned in the last year. So either you've got to sit there and say, that's it, tonight at midnight, there's no more science. We've learned all the science we can ever learn. Can you predict who's going to be a murderer? And the answer is no. We can predict who's going to be socially inappropriate, but, you know, that's about as far as the science has taken us.
All right. So what ego is simply the fuel to the car, which is your whole being, your whole self, your psychophysical vehicle. Okay, so ego fuel, car, capital S self. The ancients used a chariot for this analogy, but I imagine this will be a lot simpler for us moderns. Okay, so imagine yourself on a long road trip, or better yet, your journey of life, taking the necessitative breaks to refuel yourself whenever necessary. Now, who's doing the refueling? Well, the passengers of the vehicle. They are what we call our inner child, multiple identities we've clung to over the years, and which makes said fuel of the ego not only malleable, but also unlimited. Malleable because the driver, the passenger, and the backseat drivers will individually take turns on being the most important role. being the navigator. Being the navigator on this journey of life. Now, of course, this raises the most salient question of, well, who is the navigator? Well, whomever is refueling the car.
An animal that doesn't have a lot of behavioral flexibility, generally its reproduction strategy is multiple copies of itself, maybe hundreds, maybe thousands. And the reason for that is all the variability in the animal's behavior is genetically coded. And so for it to adapt to the transforming horizon of the future, it has to produce multiple variants of itself, most of which die. With mosquitoes, for example, they produce thousands of eggs. And if they all lived, we'd be knee deep in mosquitoes in like 10 years. But they almost all of them die because they're not matched to the transformation that's coming down the pipeline. But with human beings, what we seem to have done is evolved a mechanism for manufacturing artificial selves in this game-like manner. And so we can put forward optional selves in abstraction and then kill them off when they're not necessary without us dying. And so the famous quote, I think it was Alfred North Whitehead, was that the purpose of thought was to let our thoughts die instead of us.
I love that.
And it really makes us unique. Yeah, it's great. It's absolutely great. And so, and then it seems to me too, you tell me what you think about this, is that the abstracted artificial selves, avatars in some sense, that the prefrontal cortex generates, or that it allows these underlying motivational and emotional systems to generate, because they can generate simple avatars by themselves. I think when we describe those, we're telling stories. When we describe one of these alternative modes of action, that's precisely it. It's the verbal description of that is a story.
That's right. You know, and you make a very important point, which is that the prefrontal cortex is a rule-changing, alternate self-accessing machine that can also calm the body. And here I'm making up a gesso story because, as I always say, I wasn't consulted at the design phase, and so I don't know why it's set up this way. I just know that it is set up this way. One reason to suppress the somatic response, the bodily response, is that tends to be a unitary interpretation. Meaning at this moment, I feel alert but calm, so I feel good. But I'm guessing there's a lot of signals coming from the body, and in fact, there are to my brain, but I tend to just say, I feel pretty good. In fact, I'm very delighted to be here, so I feel good. Or if I'm very tired, I feel tired. Those tend to be very kind of binned responses, and they're fairly generic. Whereas your description of what the prefrontal cortex does, which is an accurate one, I should say, of imagining different selves and different outcomes, almost requires that we suppress how we feel in our body in the moment. You know, I guess we can look to some of our podcasting colleagues, like the Jocko Willinks or the David Goggins, you know, who are either forcing themselves or are somehow up at 4:30 in the morning and train, pushing through that, what I call limbic friction. You know, the limbic system is saying, I'm tired or I'm anxious, and, you know, going against that. So there's literally there's a required suppression of the bodily response in order to imagine how we would feel when we complete this, or how terrible we would feel.
How much of that, so let's parse that into two parts, because you can imagine there's an inhibitory component where you're directly in competition with an underlying urge. So the top-down story is, so for example, if you're responding to something in an irritable way that's being directed to you on Twitter, there's going to be a limbic rage response that's associated with that, which you can then suppress. But then the question there that's quite complex, I would say, is something like, to what degree do you think you're directly suppressing that with the prefrontal cortex? And to what degree do you think you're spinning up an alternative self that, if embodied, wouldn't require that physiological response? And so you're switching to a new identity in which that limbic response is no longer germane.
Yeah.
And so the reason that it disappears is not because you directly suppress it in an inhibitory manner, but because you replace what's necessary physiologically given your new understanding of the territory that you inhabit.
Dr. Richard Swartz of the revolutionary internal family systems model has expanded our understanding of the inner child as a more complex system of the aforementioned stigmergic identities we've attached ourselves to over our formative years to represent our inner family, or what he calls parts. Or, of course, the passengers of your psychophysical vehicle. The gestalt, the structural functional organization of whichever passenger having to refuel the car and navigate that next leg of your journey of life are no different than the practical utility of the periodic personal stories we retain throughout our lives that give us a sense of individual agency. They are Descartes' cogito ergo sum, our mantras, our ethic. These stories that help anchor ourselves, give us a map to navigate that territory called your worldview. Challenge yourself for a moment. Why is it that you are a convenient, principled individual in one scenario, and then a fragmented hypocrite in another? Our stories are just a way of affirming oneself in a moment in time, which is simply the integration of identity and self, mind and body, culture and consciousness, knowledge and wisdom, navigator and vehicle. But of course, in reality, as we've just gone over exhaustively, given our captured, normative, and definitive claims due to academia, these are simply momentary virtual simulations. Again, paving continuous roads to hell with good intentions. So no matter how glaring that Chesterton's fence may appear, you're going to drive right through that fucker if the wrong part of you happens to be the navigator on the wrong leg of your journey.
The dopamine system is in touch with the autonomic system, sure, because it has to register success versus failure of some pursuit. The prefrontal cortex is actually part of the dopamine reward system. People often overlook this, and then we just think about nucleus accumbens and ventral tegmental area. But the prefrontal cortex, because as you pointed out before, it is generating possible outcomes, different rules, different selves are being projected into the future. You can think that the two marshmallow task, the classic, you know, give kids the option to either have a marshmallow now or wait and have two marshmallows, and the cute little videos of the kids, you know, in the room with the marshmallows, sniffing it, talking to it. Occasionally a kid will just stuff it in his mouth. Another child will turn away, you know, delightful, right? And all sorts of ideas have come about how they do in life versus if they can wait or not wait. In any case, that's dopaminergic anticipation. The key thing with dopamine, I think, that encapsulates the most of it is this notion of reward prediction error, which is very simple. If you are excited and anticipating something, you are generating some internal sense of the probability of it happening. We're going to the ice cream store, kids. Let's go. We're going to have ice cream. We have ice cream. It's closed. The disappointment that they experience actually brings them far lower than they would feel, much more sad than they would feel than had you not told them you were going to get ice cream, which speaks exactly to what you were saying, that it's an anticipation signal. So dopamine's going up, 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 we're going to get ice cream, and then no. So it drops below baseline. They would have been better off being not told they were going to the ice cream store. Just drive right by.
The danger of hope.
The danger of hope. If you anticipate that it's going to be open, and again, this could translate to any scenario, and it's open, there's a dopaminergic signal upon receiving the reward, but it then drops a little bit. This is the basis of addiction, actually. Drops a little bit below baseline transiently. So we always think of the ice cream is the reward. Well, actually, the reward was right before you had that first lick of ice cream because you know you're going to get it. This is also true of sexual behavior. It's true of people who sell a company or they're anticipating something exciting or of a wedding. It also sort of partially explains this notion of postpartum depression, where people are so excited about something, the delivery of a child or something, the arrival, and then for some reason they feel let down. It's because the anticipation was that great. So many, many scenarios.
There might be an exhaustion component there too. Right. Well, it's also the case, if I remember correctly, that dopamine kick, so imagine what it does is backtrack the neural systems that were activated as the reward was approached. So then it feeds back reinforcement, not reward, but mediate cellular growth and maybe myelinization. It's increasing the efficiency of the neural connections of the systems that were activated just prior to receiving that reward in the order they were prioritized,
That's right.
In the order they were manifested. So the closer the behavior is to the receipt of the reward, the more it's reinforced and more likely to be manifested in the future. And then there's a decay function going back in time. And that's partly how an addictive subpersonality can grow too. Right, because you can imagine that there's a certain state of mind that you're in. Maybe it's a state of something approximating nihilistic hopelessness that grips you every time you're motivated to seek out your favorite drug. And that's fairly far back in the activation chain, but it's there every time you take a hit. So what happens is the dopaminergic reinforcement produced by the drug reinforces that nihilistic hopelessness that drives the drug-seeking behavior.
That's right.
And that's how, in part, you develop a monkey on your back.
Yeah, I love the example, even though I'm sad that it happens for people. I love the example because what you're saying is that, and it's exactly right, that the memory for events and states of mind and emotions that preceded a successful collection of reward or arrival at reward is set into a huge number of motor commands, some of which are subconscious.
And finally, I mentioned that fuel is also unlimited. Again, similarly to breathing without oxygen, humans cannot function without desire, without dopamine. So that car ain't running without fuel. So your being cannot function without ego. It's a non-starter. Desire can never be eliminated. Only, of course, transformed. Transformed into what? Well, to a dopamine kick. and to another dopamine kick. Identity to another identity. Codependency to codependency. Belief to belief. Ego to ego. Which makes the only thing that's objective in your life to be your objective itself. What objective? Well, whatever it is you value in this world. Now, this makes this, as history has shown us, our species' most dangerous question, because who is the person asking the question? Which fragment of your ego is sitting in the driver's seat being the navigator at this very moment? Before you answer what it is you want in this world, i.e., where is the next leg of your journey headed, you must first know where you are. I mean, makes sense, right? How do I know where I'm currently going if I don't know where I currently am? In other words, who the fuck are you? The quality of time you put into that question is exactly the willed freedom you can achieve. Now, you can't think yourself out of a thinking box, fair enough. So what is one to do? Well, think outside of it. And I have already done 90% of the heavy lifting and parsed through the captured knowledge of academia, so you don't have to. Let's try a quick thought experiment to really drive this point home. Take a moment to clear your mind, best you can. You know, deep inhale. Take a moment and pause the video as well after I ask the questions. Here we go. I want you to contemplate, not a big list, you know, top three things you truly want in this lifetime. What is it that gets you out of bed every day? Once you've completed your list of desires, you know, both tangible or otherwise, ask yourself the second question of this compassionate inquiry. At what lengths will I go to for these desires? I mean, heck, it's what you live for. Safe assumption to say it's what you die for. So as soon as you've returned from your hero's journey, you know, reviewing all the blood, sweat, and tears, beauty and glory you've obtained, it's time to ask yourself the question. Are these the desires that I truly want in this life? Or is it simply the feelings these things will apparently come with? That this route, this path, this apparent Tao equals this feeling, this emotion, that 1 + 1 = 2? I'm here to tell you that 1 + 1 = whatever you'd like it to. Because our empirical knowledge of facts is an essential part of the very ignorance that makes desire possible. And so for all of those in demand of a crystal ball to forecast that exact state of your future circumstances, listen closely. You cannot know your exact future, and we should never want to know your exact future, because mystery, i.e. what is not yet known, in other words, avidya or agnosis or being agnostic, is not only the prerequisite state of consciousness itself, but also the prerequisite state to be happy about anything. What society confuses today or its conflations with a learned helplessness of contentment. When people ask if you're happy, what they really mean to say is content. Happiness is a temporal state, a verb. Its opposite is anger. You know, no one can really be happy the entirety of their waking hours no differently than angry. You know, your muscles would simply get too sore. What we see in our culture is a conflation of happiness with superficial pleasure. So what's the difference? Well, one you can pay for, offers you all the wonderful feelings of addiction, and would of course require more in the future for satiation. Sound familiar? The other needs to be earned and bears its fruit in perpetual gratitude. I mean, just think about it. Think about the most important personal accomplishments in your life. Any major milestone, if it was simply given to you. I mean, if there was no struggle at any corner, would you feel entitled to all those wonderful fuzzy feelings that come attached with that thing? I mean, yes, of course, it may also be the root of all fear, which the modern ego is oh so familiar with. But also, a prerequisite for your excitement. When we fear, we suffer more in our stigmergic, nominalistic, artificially limited imagination of the apparent probabilistic outcomes than in reality. When we anticipate excitement, we over-index our positive expectation. There's no accurate qualitative analysis to be found.
See, the reason that socially anxious people are so interoceptive is it's involuntary.
Right.
Right? They get gripped by the negative emotion, and then that produces this intense, obsessive interoception. That might not happen if they did it voluntarily.
I see.
Because, right? Because you're going to activate an entire different system, the one you already talked about. This is why exposure therapy works so well in psychotherapy. It's like, well, I'm afraid of something, and if I go near it, then I'm possessed by negative emotion. Well, that's if you go near it accidentally. I'm going to have you go near it purposefully. And what you're going to find is that to the degree that you do it purposefully, that response will be quelled. And that happens. It's extraordinarily reliable. And it does seem to be, this is why I was wondering about gene expression. So imagine that you have someone who's habitually avoidant. And maybe they're avoidant because when they become possessed by negative emotion, they become hyper aware of their internal state and they feel the panic. And so then they freeze or retreat. And they do that constantly. And so, and then they're in this terrible negative emotional state all the time because every time they see a stimulus that's associated with retreat, they get gripped by these interoceptive sensations. And so you say to them, well, we're going to reverse that. Instead of you being gripped by that, by fiat, by the command of these underlying systems, you're going to expose yourself to that voluntarily. Now, you could imagine that what you're doing is imposing the dominance of that nucleus reunions on the anxiety-provoking systems. And so I'm wondering, see, if you do that repeatedly with people, not only do they stop being afraid of the things that you're showing them, that you're exposing them to, but they become more likely to approach other things they're afraid of, far more likely. In fact, it doesn't exactly look like people get less afraid at all. It looks like what happens is they learn to get braver, and that generalizes. And so I was wondering when I was reading your research today, is it the case that if you put someone in chronically and voluntarily into a state where, let's say, the nucleus reunions is activated, that transforms their character at the genetic level so that that's more likely to be the case in the future? So really retools them all the way down to the DNA.
Yeah, incredibly important question. It's the question, again. You're asking the exact questions that we're pursuing now. And here's the answer. There are two modes of changing these responses in the neural circuitry. One lies in so-called neuroplasticity, which is could be strengthening of synapses or just reordering of nerve connections. Could be the addition of new cells. There's a lot of excitement about the addition of new neurons, but really that only reflects a small percentage of changes in the brain of adults. It's actually more the rewiring of existing connections, but the mechanism doesn't matter so much. Something gets rewired such that the response is then different going forward. And indeed that happens. Any system that taps into the dopamine system, and indeed everything we're talking about today does, is highly subject to reward-induced neuroplasticity.
Yeah.
In fact, so much so that some of the best experiments done on this have shown that if you give somebody a drug that transiently increases dopamine, works better if you also transiently increase acetylcholine or something like that as well. But for the next hours, 1 to 4 hours, the neuroplasticity is scaled up, right? It takes many fewer trials or many fewer cognitive behavioral therapy sessions. This has only been done a few times, or many fewer learning sessions to create a permanent shift in the neurology such that—
Okay, so does that mean that if you believe when you are at the outset of a task that you're doing something important, so you're approaching a valued goal, and you have a lot of anticipation as a consequence of that, does that mean that you put yourself in a neurochemical state that facilitates learning?
Absolutely, without question.
So if you believe what you're doing is important, if you truly believe that because it's related to an important goal and it's a pathway forward, then that's going to transform into a manifestation of neuroplasticity.
Absolutely.
Taking the common game of demagoguery, identity politics played amongst our influential leadership, constantly spouting self-righteous truth claims of individualism. Oh my gosh, that word. Individual, which society clearly requires a reminder for. That word, individual, is synonymous with indivisible, i.e. cannot divide, yet every one of us are fragmented, pulled in every which direction daily by our various egoic, obligatory codependencies.
I can give an example. My girlfriend and I decided to go to the beach. We were going to do this little ritual that we've been talking about doing for a while. And I had on a piece of paper what we had written out we were going to do. And I had it in my back pocket. And we got to the ocean and the sun was setting, sort of perfect timing for this. And the piece of paper was gone. And I thought, oh my goodness, how did I screw this up? Like of all the things, I'm supposed to, I've been I'm 47 years old. This is not like I should be able to do this. You know, that
I blew it.
So I went back to the car, long walk, looking everywhere. It was not a windy day, but I thought, gosh, where's this piece of paper? Looking around, didn't find it, went all the way back to the car, wasn't the car, came all the way back, and I was walking towards her. I saw her and I thought, okay, this is really embarrassing. I'm gonna just have to wing it or remember. We didn't have our phones intentionally either, so we couldn't look it up. And then I saw the piece of paper on the beach and it was partially buried in the sand. I picked it up and I was elated. What happened there was my dopamine had dropped way below baseline. Because I was disappointed that I'd lost it, disappointed in myself, et cetera. And then I found
it. Right. So your anticipation was for nothing.
Exactly.
So you got punished by yourself for that.
Exactly.
Because that should be eradicated. If you're highly anticipatory and it doesn't make itself manifest, then you were seriously wrong. So you're going to take an emotional hit as a consequence of that. I think that's also associated, that emotional hit, that pain that you feel, I think that's actually associated with the beginning stages of the death of the systems that mediated that initial response. Because you should eradicate systems that make you anticipate that don't work, right? And that means those systems, which are already instantiated and alive in some sense, have to decay and die. And it strikes me as highly probable that you're going to pay a price in something approximating pain for the death of those malfunctioning systems. It's also why, because why wouldn't they fight for their lives to some degree? Why wouldn't they resist the decay and death that might be necessary to keep you going? Why, there should be some pain associated with that logically, because it is a biological transformation.
So, codependency is my emotional state, whether severe or subtle, is dependent on whether you positively perceive or negatively perceive said thing.
Imagine a human being that becomes insulted when he is called, he or she is called stupid. Okay?
Okay.
Someone calls them stupid, they get insulted, they get angry. The natural reaction to that is to say, well, I shouldn't get angry. Or someone else, their friend or some therapist will tell them that just because someone called you stupid, the classic thing is this, it doesn't matter what someone says to you, it's how you react.
Or don't take it personally, right?
Yes. Yeah, that's all just nonsense, okay? It doesn't matter how you react, because even if you change how you react, but you feel a certain way, that means you just change the cosmetic of your reaction. It doesn't affect how you feel. You just kind of bit your tongue, so to speak. So that's just swirling muddy water all over again.
Mm-hmm.
That doesn't get to the truth of anything. That's just cosmetics. So let's examine the truth about that. The truth, it has nothing to do with how you should behave if someone calls you stupid. It has to do with, here's the question. If someone calls this person stupid and the person gets angry, the question is, why did they become angry? Naturally, if we get the cosmetic out of the way, because the first five answers that you get are always wrong, because they're top of the head and they're superficial, you know, one of the first answers would be, well, the reason I got angry, was because I was called stupid. Well, no, it's not true. Because if that person called you a cloud, would you get angry? No. Why not? The reason that you wouldn't get angry if someone called you a cloud was because you knew in very certain terms that you weren't a cloud. If they called you a bird, you know that you're not a bird, so you wouldn't get angry. Then why do you get angry when they call you stupid? The reason that the person would get angry if someone called them stupid, the reason that anger arose, not how to deal with the anger, not what's the best way to manage it, all this silly nonsense. What is the reason that the anger arose? The reason that the anger arose is because when the person was called stupid, something inside that person seriously entertained the possibility that they were in fact stupid. When that possibility was entertained, then another part of them, the egoic part of them, did not like the fact that a part of them entertained the idea that they were stupid. That produces internal conflict. That internal conflict outwardly manifested itself as anger. Now we have the systematology and the pathophysiology of why the anger arose. When someone sees that, then they are able to truly dissect the nucleus of the issue, which in this case would be, why is it that a part of me seriously entertains the possibility of me being stupid? That becomes the focus, and the focus does not become the silliness about how I should react next time.
The problem is, we think that when it comes to our stigmergic relationship with drugs or dogma, we think they're any different. The problem is, when you wake up in the morning, you think you're sober.
You know, one thing about the dopamine system that's so important and also explains a lot of pathology, but also a lot of human evolution, is that we have basically one major reward system, which is the dopaminergic system. You know, I sometimes like the analogy that, you know, nowadays you hear about cryptocurrency or the dollar versus the euro versus the this versus the that. There's only one currency in all of reality, actually, and it's dopamine. Whether or not it's the dollar-backed dopamine or it's euro-backed dopamine or Bitcoin-backed dopamine, in the end, whether or not someone has $1 billion or $2 is really that currency resides as something that's transacted in the real world, but their notion of power and potential is dopaminergic. And so too, the potential for mates, the potential for food, how much food you have, you know, how much meat you have stored in the freezer tells you a lot about your security and well-being for you and your family, right? And that's, but, and that is translated into a dopaminergic internal representation.
What separates man from animal? Well, in this simple, descriptive, and vapid scientific terms, that'll satisfy your weekly egoic circle jerk quota. Metacognition, you know, the ability to not just induct, not just deduct, but abduct. But in more meaningful existential terms, it is the option, the choice for utopia. Animals have no choice, none, but to agree with the circumstances in which it's dealt. Human beings, on the other hand, do not. Therefore, any, oh, that's human nature, or it is what it is, or any God of the gaps diagnosis, thinking of a learned helplessness from someone in any position of leadership, should be challenged with minimal regard for etiquette. For what? I mean, they're fallacious, they're animalistic yielding to their apparent powerlessness. Of course, challenging is an understatement given the consequences of those who are at our highest concentrations of wealth today, parroting pseudo contingencies that any adequate psychedelic session would clearly reveal are simple projections of their own ineptitudes.
So imagine, I, this is a good story. So you can imagine two people laying bricks, they're building a gigantic wall, and the one person thinks, oh my God, you know, wall is going to take 100,000 bricks and I'm laying one at a time and I'm wasting my life away trivially adding to this gigantic brick wall. And what am I doing? This is absolutely miserable, brick by brick. And the other person thinks in 300 years, this is going to be a cathedral. And so the person in the second state is doing exactly the same thing at a local level, laying bricks, but each brick is related to a very high goal. And that means the reward that's attendant upon the laying of the brick is proportional to the goal, to the to the aim of the entire behavioral process. And so it seems to me, so if you're aimless and goalless, and I know you've done some work on goal setting, if you're aimless and goalless, then you can't elicit any positive emotion. And if your goals are fragmented, which is also what happens if you're aimless or your goals lack unity, if your goals are fragmented, then no given behavioral manifestation can elicit any dopaminergic reward because it's not a step forward to anything desirable. And so there's no positive emotion. And so you can't learn. Well, according to your account, I didn't know that. See, I didn't know that when you put yourself in a state of apprehension in relationship to a valued goal, that your neuroplasticity improves and you can learn better. That's very, very cool.
We've all had the experience of hearing statements a matter-of-factly, you know, with a preceding feeling of, oh yeah, that's logical. We all innately feel able to reason from causes and effects. But how does one create rules for valid and intuitive inferences? Since we've been really bringing it back to basics today, we only come to understand anything in this life through a principle of triangulation, where your first step is a consideration of a proposed truth from a trusted source, and that can be from somewhere external or your own internal intuition. You know, today, my hope, of course, is to qualify as one of those sources of trust. The second you begin to explore what these apparently wise claims are all about, you know, absorbing as many primary, secondary, tertiary sources, etc. And finally, most crucial of all, and the very thing that delineates knowing something versus understanding something, which you see so rarely in society today, and whom, yes, some of the sources in the curriculum are undoubtedly guilty of, as you probably just saw, an actual application of the informed wisdom onto your own life so that you can finally have the firsthand experience of what was originally claimed. That's why we use myth. That's why we use metaphor and analogy to convey our phenomenology and attempt to be in communion with another.
So we have our mind. It thinks about something. Then you speak it to somebody. It has a certain meaning. But that's not enough. You need someone to hear it. And they hear it, and those words take on a denotation, a connotation. All of those things that make a word striking to you, you could understand it within a context. That is the third element in this. St. Augustine says something similar. He says that there is, in all the world, everything is divided up into three. There is the knower, there is the object known, and then there is the state of knowing that object. Everything, all of our actions have a threefold nature. There is its origin, there is its activity, and the fact that that activity can be communicated to others, and other people can look at it and interpret it. There are always three things in how human beings function. There's always a source, there's always an action, and then there's always a context of understanding. All three of them have to exist at the same time. All three of them have to be functional relative to each other, or it's all nonsense.
Dr. Anderson, in a conversation with Krishnamurti, it's 18 conversations of pure wisdom, and should be no surprise as to why it's part of the essential curriculum. Dr. Anderson shares a paraphrasing by Kierkegaard, who captures this wonderfully.
The point that you're making, it seems to me, is made also by the great Danish thinker Kierkegaard, who lived a very trying life in his own community, because he was asking them, it seems to me, to undertake what you're saying. He was saying, look, if I go to seminary and I try to understand what Christianity is by studying at my desk, then what I'm doing is appropriating something here. But then when do I know when I've appropriated it fully? I shall never know that point. Right. Therefore, I shall forever appropriate it and never do anything about it as such, as a subject, the person who must risk the deed, not the utterance of what someone has said before, or not simply thinking through what someone has thought before, but actually embodying the meaning through the observation of myself in relation to that.
Quite, quite.
And that has always seemed to me a very profound insight. But one of the ironies of that is, of course, in the academy, we have an endless proliferation of studies in which scholars have learned Danish in order to understand Kierkegaard. And what they're doing is, to a large extent, if I haven't misjudged the spirit of much that I've read, is simply perpetuate the very thing he said should be cut.
How many opinions do you have from simply parroting another? So truth, any truth, is simply a contradiction. It's a paradox. It's a hypocrisy. That has been solved. It's been solved within what? Within that specific context, within that idiosyncrasy. If it hasn't been solved, it remains a paradox. That's it. There, you now have an algorithm to solve for truth claims amongst your Dunbar. So, if your relationships are still in conflict versus the potential communion that's right around the corner, improve the quality of your questions. What does quality mean? An expansion of variables for consideration. Can't think of any? Well, not to worry. The links are all down below. Let me illustrate this with some examples that show up in culture today. Okay, within the domain of entrepreneurship, the common idiom, you got to spend money to make money, will remain a paradox to those who have little to no experience in the field, let alone the idiosyncrasies of the scenario being discussed. Trust but verify, in any professional context, is understood by the agents participating in a field where the dynamism of the relationship requires a degree of confidence as well as a degree of skepticism, so that both parties can feel secure when exploring that novel territory in their relationship. Okay. Moving to a more technical arena. What about a relationship with all these smart devices? You know, most of you, well, omitting the intellectual might of the TOE audience here, most of you know how your smartphone works, yet have no understanding of how the components of the device intersect to give you that oh-so-lovely end-user experience we all take for granted for every day. That change in every sense of that word is the only constant. And yes, I'm even including the rate of disturbance of the ether that gives us that familiar appearance of illumination we call light. Just ask Kenner Sheldrake. If I haven't spelt out such a profound discovery clearly enough, let's attempt another angle. Whenever anyone, in any context, claims your proposition to be hypocritical, to be paradoxical, that you're not making any sense, what they are simply admitting to, unwittingly of course, given it's a projection of theirs, a projection of what? Of their own inexperience, of their own ignorance of the substance, of the essence, of the syntactical proposition being proposed by its author. The receiver of this information is failing a simple task that we all proclaim to be doing, but in fact, take for granted every single day. Listening. Which, since this day has been full of reminders, listening means not just hearing the descriptive nominal claim, but then a deduction of the author's subjective normative proposition. You know, always applying Grice's razor. So if you haven't approached a mutual understanding, the burden is on all who are involved to improve the quality of your questions. Now, our unidentified stigmergic trauma, of course, will reflexively have the receiver deduce their own personal projections, as we have just learned. So I would just like to finally say that if there's anyone out there today expecting to believe and resonate with every single one of my utterances today, after what I just characterized as unbelievable, what could only be described as unbelievable claims, a reminder that that word means not to be believed until, of course, you experience it for yourself. Thank you.
That's what Jesus taught. What was his statement in that most pronounced, and it's very simplistic. The kingdom of God is within you. Seek it first before you do anything. Look inside of yourself first for the kingdom of God. The single eye, the light of the body is the eye. If your eye be single, your whole body shall be filled with light. Jesus taught that one should look within themselves to find the fulfillment of God. And the search should be conducted by stimulating the pineal gland of the brain. He was very specific, and you saw it. If your eye be single, your body will fill with light. And he amplified these instructions by telling us to take no thought. In other words, shut down the brain. Move to a new direction. And he told us to watch. He said very clearly, what I say to you, I say to all. Watch. What are you going to watch? Activate the pineal gland. Eliminate the thoughts of the mind. Watch and look for something otherworldly, something special, something higher, something filled with nature, something filled with love, something filled with light. And you'll never find it by watching politicians or religious people. You've got to go directly to the source, which is the supreme light, which is in you. And the Bible is very, very specific. We are children of light. In other words, light, which we are not supposed to focus on people or churches or religions. It's all minds and brains and competition. Light, which is we, are to concentrate on the supreme light, which is God. And that supreme light can only be realized by looking within yourself, not looking within me, looking within yourself. So finally we're able to focus on the true natures of ourself and God, and we come up with that beautiful, strange word that was coined by Albert Einstein, which is photon. What is a photon? A photon is a particle of light. It's an angle of light. It comes down from above, and it's a messenger particle. My goodness gracious, what more do you need to understand what an angel is? It's light, it's an angel, it's an angle, it's a messenger of God, which is an angel of light. That's what a photon is. And that's what we are. That's what you are. I mean, over and over and over, we struggle with this thing. Your body is a machine. Who's operating that machine? Your brain is incapable of creating a single thought. Well, how come you're thinking? Because somebody is programming that thing on top of here. Who's programming it? You are. What are you? You're the photon. You're the angle of light that came down from above. And this light, these photons travel in waves throughout the universe, through everywhere, waves going through, light waves, sound waves going all over, inundated everything. So we have these things and they travel in waves, and suddenly though, when you turn your attention to them, according to the science, the wave collapses to a particle. Boom, and it becomes something. It becomes a particle, and then all of a sudden it becomes reality. But it doesn't become reality until somebody looks at it. See? Last we looked at a precise way in which all this happens, and I just want to, just for a minute, okay? The phenomenon addressed both by science and by the Bible, and what is it called? It's called a wave offering. Huh? Did you ever know that? Did you ever know that science teaches us about a wave offering and that the Bible teaches us about a wave offering? There's a symphony of sound that flows through the universe. A symphony of sound that creates and impacts all things. And now science is showing us that they believe that crop circles, legitimate crop circles, are formed by sound waves. Frequencies of sound creating these forms on the earth, changing things by sound. And now science has told us that they have heard the first primordial sound that actually created the Big Bang. That it was a sound, it was a hum-like sound, an ohm-like sound, if you would, that created the universe. These are waves, they're invisible sound waves, there's invisible light waves, but when we watch them, suddenly we turn our attention, there it is, it collapses and it becomes reality. But it requires an observation. It's all part of life, it's part of nature, it's the way it works, nothing religious about it. The light makes an offering, and the light within the physical body responds to that offering. There's a light being out there that makes an offering, and there's a light being inside of you that responds to that offering. It's a wave offering. Look at the work, real quick, of John Gribbins, who is one of the most eminent physicists from London, from his book, Schrodinger's Kittens and the Search for Reality. In Overhead 176, he's talking about the interaction of photons and electrons between the universe and the Earth. And in paragraph 2, he says it works like this. When an electron vibrates, it attempts to radiate by producing a field which is a wave going into the future and a wave going into the past. So something is happening. The wave heads off into the future until it encounters an electron which can absorb that. So, in other words, we have waves. We have waves of electromagnetic forms between the Earth and us. Something is happening. An electron is vibrating, and it's trying to find something to receive it. It's trying to find an absorber, okay? Now, look at what this eminent physicist from London says, okay? In Kramer, the emitter, which is God, can be considered to produce an offer wave, which travels to the absorber, that's us, okay? The absorber then returns a confirmation wave to the emitter. In other words, the offering wave is made and the transaction is completed with a handshake across space and time. Well, this is a scientific reality. In other words, this eminent physicist is explaining to us how light interacts with light. It is done by an offering wave. And the Bible is telling us that you make an offering wave to the Lord. I mean, what is this, a big coincidence? Somebody wrote 6,000 years ago about an offer wave in the Bible, and this guy's writing a couple of years ago in London as a physicist about an offering wave of light, and the Bible says that God is light. Is it all a coincidence? Of course it's not a coincidence. It's fact. It's reality. It's the way this works. Huh? It's the way this works. As we saw in these scriptures, that's a requirement of the Bible. Now, what is critical here is to consider that the wave offering in the Bible is to create a communication for that which is above and that which is below. When the Bible says make a wave offering, it's talking about you're doing that because you're trying to communicate with something which is above. And the wave offering spoken of by Kramer and Gribbins, the physicist, is to create a communication from that which is above and that which is below. It's the same thing. Mainly, we're talking about a brain. The light in you is connected to the brain in you, which in combination makes you a human being. If that photon in you leaves, the body that you have is no longer a human being. It is what now? It's a dead body. But that's what we are, and we're so attached to the physical, we do not understand that which is the light, the reality. And looking at the universe, so because we're talking about a brain, we're talking about the human brain. What is your human brain? We looked at the universe in overhead 427. It says how the first galaxies were born. And it's talking about the cosmos. And it says it's spongy just like your brain. The early universe contained a series of threads, not unlike a spider web. The universe looks like a spider web. This is NASA talking. A spider web. And it says here, they were found to a filament supporting a popular theory of the cosmic web. The discovery bolsters the concept of the cosmic web, the spider web. Look at overhead 428. In overhead 428, it describes the early universe. Computer models see the variations that the components of the universe, the spider web. So you say, well, so what? Why is that important? Now, let me show you why it's important in overhead 429. Here's the important part. One of the most important parts of the brain is something called arachnoid. Well, it's a covering that lies between the outer part of the brain and the inner part of the brain, and it's called arachnoid. A delicate membrane enclosing the spinal cord in the brain. And what is it? It's a spider's web. What is this, a big joke at everybody's? Don't you hear anybody pulling your chain trying to get your attention? And what is this saying? It's saying that you live inside the cosmic brain of God. The brain, when you look up into the sky, you're looking up into a brain. It's the same thing. Why is the brain, according to the scientists and the astronomers and the astrophysicists, look just like the universe, and the universe looks just like the brain? Because they're one and the same. Why I'm raising this issue is because we're speaking about a wave offering. We're speaking about a wave offering described to us by physicists. We're speaking about a wave offering described to us in the Bible. And now we see that the human brain is very similar to the universe as a cosmic web. And we consider the wave offering, we run into an interesting thing when we define that word wave. Look at overhead 455. When we look at the word wave that we've been looking at, and we get down to important derivatives, look at the word we come up with, web, weaving. And what weaves a web? The spider, the spider's web. And so you make an offering wave, and you're making the offering web, and its brain being receiving that which is the light coming down from above and interacting with the light which is inside of you, which is operating your brain. So we have the wave offering, not only confirmed by both the Bible and science, you can take that down, but now we have connected it to the web, which we find the brain-universe comparison. So how much more proof? I mean, think of this logically. And that's like I said, would it seem reasonable to instruct someone to stand with a piece of meat out on a rock and wave it to some invisible God in the sky somewhere? Is that what's supposed to be logical? Is that why you have a Bible? The Holy Word of God? Of course not. But you have the Holy Word of God because it's telling something true. It's telling something real. It's telling something that we understand now is being proven by scientists. But unfortunately, those who are following the dictates of these various religious groups aren't allowed to look at this because it doesn't say that in their books. Well, with the scientific reality of a wave offering in which intelligent lights entracts intelligent light inside and outside, that to me is credible. That's reasonable.
That's in the realm of what you call spirit or soul. It just makes sense. The entire matter that the Bible addresses is talking about the light, the photons, the waves, the particles. God is light. You are light. It is not relating to the body. The body exists for you to have experience, for you to sense, for you to communicate, for you to build. But it is light which runs that body. It is light which operates that body. It is a little light that thinks and programs the brain. You say, well, that's crazy. Read sometimes these quantum physics books and you'll find out about what they call nonsense and what Albert Einstein called spooky action at a distance. It is a wild, wild world. Once the death of the body occurs, the physical senses are gone. At that point, when the light rises out of the body, it doesn't take part in physical things. It is an angel in heaven. It is an angle of light in the ether. It is an entirely different realm. This is where the subject of collapsing the wave to a particle becomes very interesting, because it is based on the problem of possibility. It says that when the wave function collapses, possibilities occur. Billions and billions and billions of possibilities. But one thing will happen. When you make an observation and you interact, in whatever course you do, you will cause all of the other realms of possibilities to cease, to vanish. There will only be one thing, and you'll create it by what you do. So all these things are built, wave functions are built around probabilities and possibilities. In other words, the system is observed and all the possibilities cease to occur except one. The next thought is it necessary for someone actually to be watching to clap? Everything in life is in a form of a wave. It's an invisible wave, and when something or somebody observes it, instantly it collapses to a particle and becomes a reality. That's the way life works. That's why Jesus says, what I say to you, I say to all, watch. Because what you're doing when you're watching inside of yourself, you're watching for God, you're watching for angels, you're watching for spirit, you're watching for reality, you suddenly cause that invisible wave of God to collapse to reality. But what's important is because that's what science is talking about today. Watching, observing, changing by collapsing the wave. Okay. Now I want to show you something that's quite interesting from Gary Zukav from his book, The Dancing Woolly Master. He says, according to classical physics, the light source emitted a real particle, a photon, and it traveled, the detector recorded. According to quantum mechanics, this is not so. No real particle called a photon traveled between the light source and the screen. There was no photon until one actualized. Until then, there was only a wave function. In other words, until then, all that existed were tendencies to actualize. So nothing was there until somebody observed it. Nothing was there until somebody looked at it, see? There is no photon. There is only a developing potential. There is only something that might happen. The actuality depends on some kind of observation. Without that observation, only the wave exists. Nothing else exists. Without perception, in other words, if you don't look, the universe continues to generate an endless amount of possibilities. The effect of perception, however, that's when you turn and look, is immediate and dramatic. All the wave function representing the observed system collapses, except one part which actualizes into reality. Some type of detection by an observing system is required to collapse the wave function of the observed system into a physical reality. This is a scientist telling you that. It's not a preacher. It's not a minister. It's not a rabbi. It's not New Age. It's not Old Age. It's the fact. It's the truth. It's the way things work.